Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Well, Egypt on Friday have welcomed the decision of the International Court of Justice to take immediate measures to protect the Palestinian civilians in the Gaza, as the UN top court said that Israel must prevent genocide acts in Gaza and facilitate urgently needed humanitarian aid in the besieged territory, handing down the ruling in a case that has drawn global attention. Well, to shed more light on this, we have the pleasure to have with us over the phone His Excellency Ambassador Mithat El Meligi, former Assistant Foreign Minister. Good morning, Your Excellency.
Good morning to you.
Well, Your Excellency, how did you read the ruling by the International Court of Justice?
Well, I think, first of all, we have to all agree that this is a historical movement and historical ruling in favor of the Palestinian cause, once that is legal beside many political and international decisions before that from the Security Council, and before that from the General Assembly of the United Nations.
Yes.
For the first time, we have a legal binding document that stipulates that Israel might be committing war crimes and genocide.
Yes.
And this is, I think, it's very important, although that the ruling is not as many people have expected, but it is very important what happened.
Yes, Your Excellency Ambassador Meligi, the court stood short before stood short from saying recommending a ceasefire. So, what is the reason behind this?
Well, first of all, let me assure you something. In such rulings, you cannot have everything. I mean, we all remember the very famous resolution of the Security Council. 242, which is, as you know, it says occupied territories and that Israel should withdraw from occupied territories or the occupied territories. And this actually formulation of the resolution in itself gives everyone something. The world is always thinking that it has to be fair, and fair according to many organizations is to either praise or blame both sides. And I think this is one of the reasons why. The second reason, which is quite important, they cannot ask for a ceasefire. This was not about a ceasefire. Of course, a ceasefire is implied because the United Nations and the international community cannot order something that was not originally asked. It was one of the demands of South Africa, but mainly we are talking about genocide. And in order to do so, they have to have a ceasefire. You cannot stop the massacres that is going on. You cannot, as ordered by the International Court of Justice, you cannot implement the humanitarian aid and the medical aid and the safety of the Palestinian without, by default, ask for a ceasefire. And I think this is going to be the role of the Security Council, because the Security Council now has to study, and we've heard yesterday the Secretary General of the United Nations saying that he is referring the ruling, the sixth rules of the International Court of Justice, he is referring this to the Security Council to come out with abiding rules regarding what is going to be the next step.
Yes, Your Excellency Ambassador Meligi, so this means that a lawsuit is needed to be raised concerning the ceasefire or to be related to or linked to the main suit. Isn't it? Is this going, in your expectation, is going to
well,
be the second
we
step?
We have two options here, and it's still too early. It's not even 24 hours since the ruling appeared.
Yes.
The first one is that Israel would abide by the resolutions and by the measures directly. you know, what is called the emergency interim ruling.
Yes.
So they will either respect it directly, or we will have the Security Council to order Israel by that. And I think the most important player in this issue will be the United States, and whether it's going to use its power as one of the permanent security members, of the Security Council members, if it's going to be using the veto in order not to allow Israel to abide by the rulings, or it is going to comply with the decision of the court and ask for a ceasefire and the implementation, the full implementation of the six rulings of the International Court of Justice.
Yes, for his part, President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi held a phone call yesterday with the U.S. President Joe Biden, during which both leaders had the same stance concerning the genocide case. So that was also very important, because Egypt is pressing also and is not leaving the case and is exerting all efforts. So also, Your Excellency Ambassador Melighi, my question now, the decision by the International Court of Justice and the recommendations or the ruling of the court, can we say that this ruling could drive some supporting countries to Israel to be cautious in dealing with the situation and be cautious or review its stance in supporting Israel or financing Israel's by providing it with weapons or something?
Well, of course. This is very important.
Yes.
That now there is a ground and there is a cover and an umbrella, a legal umbrella for all the countries in the world that they cannot anymore help Israel to commit the genocide that is taking place.
Mm.
Although it wasn't, I mean, this is not a final ruling, as we all know. This is just provisional measures in order to prevent any possibility of a genocide to be committed against the Palestinians. However, this is the coverage that we all need, that we have all to respect, since the ruling of the International Court of Justice is compulsory. It's not optional, and Israel has to abide by it, and all the countries that are supporting Israel will either comply with it by not helping Israel to commit this genocide, or by being part and being a member and perpetrators and complicating with Israel in committing the war crime.
Yes. So, Your Excellency Ambassador Melighi, so can we expect sanctions to be put on Israel, or a kind of blockade on Israel, like what it did with the Gaza Strip?
Well, we can expect anything. As I said from the beginning, the most important step is the one of the Security Council. What is it going to do? As we all heard yesterday, Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister of Israel, saying that the war will continue. Of course, we understand the internal reasons that is pushing him to say so and to continue in this war, since he knows that his personal political future depends on the continuation of the war. And as long as the international community, and especially the United States, are going to help him to continue with this war, he will not stop. The ruling of impunity, this is the most dangerous thing in the current situation. As long as Israel thinks that it can go without any repercussions of or consequences of what it's doing, we are going to continue in this war. Unfortunately, the United States is the greater supporter of Israel, and it is the only one who can really pressure Israel into abiding by the ruling of the court and to apply the six provisional measures that were decided by the International Court of Justice. We all have to wait. How is it going to be? Israel, as we all know it, by default, by history, will not comply simply with the ruling of the International Court of Justice. The Security Council has to push it forward in order to force Israel to support it. And in this situation, if we do not have the support of the United States, none of this will happen, except that we will have one historical ruling against Israel to prove once again that what Israel is committing is a crime and is a genocide.
Yes. So, Your Excellency Ambassador Miligi, the crimes, the war crimes that is made by Israel was very clear to everyone in the whole world. We saw videos, we saw everything was very clear that this is war crimes attacking the civilians, children, women, pregnant women, not allowing medicine for the citizens.
I totally agree with what you are saying, and this is our vision to the situation. Unfortunately, we have to respect the ruling of the International Court of Justice. This is what they have decided. This is what they have ruled. As we know, they stopped short before asking
the ceasefire.
A complete ceasefire. However, you cannot, and this is a very important thing. By default, you cannot apply the six rulings of the International Court of Justice without having a ceasefire. How can I protect the Palestinian if the war is still going on?
Yes.
How can I enter all the humanitarian aid and the medical aid and the fuel and everything if the war is still going on? So by default, the court did not say it, but by default it has to be applied, or else the six measures will cannot be applied. And let's not forget one thing. The most important thing is the case of genocide, and this has been, by many evidences presented and spoken by the court itself, has been to a very large extent proven. However, they cannot ask for a ceasefire because their role is not to stop the war. The war is to decide whether there is a genocide committed against the Palestinians or not. And according to the evidences presented by the court itself and read from the court, and based on the statements and the press releases from the officials of Israel, it was proven without a shred of a doubt that there is a genocide that is committing against the Palestinians. However, stopping the war will be the job of the Security Council, who will implement this by force if they want to apply the rule of the International Court of Justice. All the whole system, the whole justice system, unfortunately, will collapse because Israel will once again prove that it's above the law. And this is what we don't want. We respect the law. All the love and peace-loving countries and the respectful countries have said that they will respect the court and what it has decided. We have seen even Germany, who have earlier spoken that it will side with Israel, said that it will respect the ruling of the court.
Yeah.
Now, the most important thing is to see this implemented officially by the Security Council of the United Nations.
Yes. So, Your Excellency Ambassador Miligi, how do you see Israel as a country who have violated the international laws during its war on Gaza Strip?
Well, we all know what happened.
All
the humanitarian organizations have seen it. The Human Rights Watch and International Amnesty and all of them, and even independent organizations, all of them have seen, and even the Secretary General of the United Nations have spoke about it, and many peace-loving countries have expressed their dismay with what Israel is doing. So we all know that Israel has committed a war crime. You cannot kill 30,000, almost 30,000 person, and you say this is a war, which most of them, unfortunately, are women and children and elderly people. So the crime is here. The conviction is almost here, because we cannot say that this is a ruling, but all the evidences are pointing that Israel is indeed in committing a war crime, which is the genocide. So everything is pointing to that. So there is no more doubt about it. And anybody in any country who is seeking a legal coverage, you got it now. You have the International Court of Justice, who represents the conscience of the humanity, have spoken and said that Israel has to stop anything or even to incite on that. They have to stop all acts that could lead to more killings of Palestinians. Now there is the force of the law. What is left is the force of the politics, and to be able to force Israel to comply with the rulings and to respect them and to abide by them.
Yes, Your Excellency Ambassador Miligi, how long would the court take? I mean, the sessions of this court, how long may it take?
Well, we have taken approximately 2 weeks to have the provisional measures that we've seen.
Yes.
However, as concerning the ruling itself, this might take years.
Yes,
as we know, this
yes.
is not the only case. We have other cases that hasn't been ruled out
yes.
yet. As we know, there is another case against
yes.
Russia and against President Putin. We
yes.
have against Myanmar for the massacres of the Muslim minority. We have many cases that hasn't been ruled yet. But however, what I want to say here, since we brought up these two cases, that of course, although it was much stronger, the rulings, the provisional rulings that came out of them, even President Putin, is there is a warrant against him, although he's a president of one of the great powers and one of the permanent member of the Security Council. However, there is a warrant against him. What I want to say is that although these rulings are a little weaker than what we have seen earlier in other cases or in similar cases of genocide, but no court have been subject to such pressure as the one we heard about. The Western world and I might even say the United States have tried as much as they can to not have a ruling against Israel. And that's why maybe we didn't hear the word ceasefire coming out of the head of the court. What I have to say here is that although this has happened, but we still have a very important ruling, and we still have a very legal, strong document now that can help to draw a map, a roadmap to what can be the next step. We have to stop the genocide. We have to stop any killing of Palestinians.
Yes.
It's all about how to implement that. And I think that 90%, if not more, is in the hands of the United States today, whether they are going to force Israel to comply with that or they are going to try to find a way that Israel can go on and continue waging its war on the poor and innocent Palestinians and the civilian Palestinians, as was said by the court itself.
Yes, so Your Excellency Ambassador Miligi, can we say that the ruling is very important because it's a binding ruling and cannot be appealed?
Yes, it's true. It's a binding rule. However, the International Court of Justice does not have the means to implement it without the Security Council. That's why I said from the beginning that it's up to the Security Council now to exert its powers into forcing Israel to comply with it. We heard it already. Yesterday, the Prime Minister said that he will not stop the war. And actually, according to the law, he can say that he is not going to apply because it did not order him. But in order to comply with the other six rulings, he cannot do it without a ceasefire. So a ceasefire is imminent, and Israel has to respect that, and the United States and the other members of the Security Council will have to force Israel to that. I heard,
yes.
and I think we all heard, that Algeria, since it's the only voice of the Arab world in the Security Council,
yes.
is planning to present a document to ask Israel to cease fire, and also the Secretary General of the United Nations. According to his job, he has to ask the Security Council to issue the resolution that is requested to force Israel to comply.
I thank you very much for your time. Thank you also for your valuable information. I really had the honor to have this phone with you. Thank you very much, Your Excellency, Ambassador Mithat El-Maliki, former Assistant Foreign Minister. Thank you very much for joining us over the phone. Ladies and gentlemen, a short break, and I'm going to be back with you.